I read this book twice last week, and I'm gonna be honest, I didn't really get what I wanted from it. What's up, marketers? Welcome to the first session of Advertising Book Club. Maybe we'll do this thing more often, or if this video is a total flop, ugh. Also, be sure to stay to the end of the video where I show you the video that I'm going to be reading for next time so that you can read it along with me. Today's subject is The Famed Scientific Advertising by Claude Hopkins. I feel like every single marketer worth their salt that I really respect suggests reading this book, and they will say something crazy like, you gotta read this book 7 times, or I read this book 50 times. So it should surprise you that I gave this book a 1.5 out of 5, but you already know that. The reality is I do not suggest new advertisers to read this book without a very big disclaimer. But what I do suggest is watch this video. We're gonna squeeze every single learning that you can get from this book. And more importantly, we're gonna learn about Claude Hopkins and his most famous ads. This is really important stuff, and I feel like most people are gonna learn more from reading his actual ads than reading this book for the first time. Now, who was Claude Hopkins? He was an ad man of a totally different era. He came way before Ogilvy, before the Mad Men era. His ads looked like this and this. This was even before radio was popularized. He was born in 1866, 1 year after the Civil War ended, and he died in 1932, just a few years into the Great Depression. So his most active years as an advertiser saw the sinking of the Titanic, World War I, and again, the beginning of the Great Depression. He's most famous for a few things. Number one, something I really respect, he was an expensive ad man. In 1907, when he was hired by Lord & Thomas, an advertising agency out of Chicago, he was paid $185,000 per year, which is the equivalent of $6 million in today's exchange. He invented reason why advertising, which essentially means that your advertising should give people reasons why to buy your product and why it was better than competing products and alternative uses regardless of a customer's budget. Reason why advertising essentially means your advertising needs to make money, and he explained that it should really help a salesman be able to sell your product. If you are creating advertisements that don't actually help people to sell that are on the ground, then it's probably not a good ad. He also invented the concept of test campaigns, which if you are advertising on Meta at all in 2024, you are doing a lot of test campaigns. We are running a lot of test advertisements. In fact, a lot of big brands will test some messaging on Meta ads to then create bigger advertisements on billboards or in commercials or whatever. And he did a lot of these test campaigns through mail order advertising. That was really his bread and butter. And something I wanna underscore about Hopkins is a lot of things that people credit Ogilvy to were actually Claude Hopkins. So this idea of using specificity in your marketing and how important that is, the importance of a headline and facts as a way of selling, all of these things were actually things that Hopkins taught Ogilvy. Now let's talk about some of his most famous ads. I think this is the real bread and butter of this video. So when I posted this story and showed people how low my rating was of this book, I had a few people hit me up in the DMs and say, hey, actually you're gonna learn a lot more from reading his actual ads than reading his book, especially at a first pass. And this is something that I totally agree with, which is why I think that before anyone picks up this book, you should really be taking a look at the ads that he made. And so, you know, when you're going through this book, you're not gonna see them. This isn't Ogilvy on advertising. This is all, you know, like kind of like a manifesto, but more on that in a bit. So some of Hopkins' most famous ads include Palmolive soap, selling condensed milk to housewives, and some car ads, spoken like a true person who doesn't have a driver's license. But I wanna talk to you about the three ads that he's most well known for, which are Pepsodent, Schilt's beer, and puffed rice. First up, let's take a look at this Pepsodent ad. Now, Claude Hopkins is actually credited for popularizing Americans brushing their teeth. Specifically, he coined that term, the film. So the idea of brushing the film off of your teeth after a long day, first thing in the morning, this is something that he really popularized. He also positioned Pepsodent not as a hygiene product, but more as a beauty product, which is what we see a lot of health brands doing today. Hopkins, a lot like Ogilvy, is someone who would do a ton of research on the subject that he was making advertisements about. And it was actually in the middle of a boring dental textbook that he found one doctor refer to certain plaque as the film. So he positioned this product as something that would remove that film, even though technically that was not something that was ever specifically tested, and positioned the toothpaste as something that would create more beauty. What's so interesting is during this time, people really didn't have that habit of brushing their teeth, especially two times a day, or even daily for that matter. But he found a cue that already existed. People want to be more beautiful. And he had an irresistible offer that people couldn't refuse. 10 days for free. Within just 3 weeks of launching the campaign, demand exploded. Within a decade of this campaign, 75% of Americans had Pepsodent in their medicine cabinet. They were America's best-selling toothpaste for over 30 years. Now the next ad, Schilt's Beer. Now Schilt's Beer, we won't spend as long as this one because I think this one's a lot more simple, but I do think it's really interesting how a lot of these old ads position beer as something that's healthy. It's definitely not something that we would be doing in 2024. But the big thing that Hopkins attributed the success of these campaigns to was actually by showing how pure this beer was. Now, what's interesting is a lot of brands at the time were talking about the purity, but in Hopkins' ads, he actually shared how the beer was manufactured, which was not something that advertisers were doing. Now, I think that this is really interesting because we think about how in 2024, a lot of the behind the scenes marketing, founders ads, are something that really seems to resonate with Gen Z, millennials, even a little bit older and across the board. And I think that that idea, that behind the scenes action, is part of the reason why these Schilt's Beer ads were so effective. Because it's one thing to say that you're the most pure or the most whatever, but it's a whole lot different to actually show the behind the scenes of how you're being manufactured. Next up, the Puffed Wheat ad. Hopkins was actually touring a manufacturing plant when he saw how this puffed rice was actually being made, which again, we think back to the success the Schilt's Beer ad. Now we have the Puffed Rice ad, and we can see a little bit of behind the scenes on how a specific product is being manufactured. The interesting thing that Hopkins says about this ad, the Schilt's Beer ad, is he was really tapping into a hidden remarkability, which is that sort of behind the scenes aspect that I'm talking about. But of course, these Guns of Peace were just the headlines, right? They also went into the nutritional benefits, how you could serve it hot or cold. So it was really convenient. Now, the interesting thing about this ad too, historically, is this ad first ran in 1930, which was just a few months after the beginning of the Great Depression. So even when thinking about the convenience factors and even the headline that's most likely to appeal, right? So Great Depression, there's a little bit of unrest, there's a little bit of uneasiness, but being able to lean into that positivity angle, I think is something that he was really intentional about, and I will get into that in a minute. The really big takeaway from all of these ads is you really have to do your research, and your research might come from the most unlikely of places. And some places that you can look into it are, of course, your reason, your why, but also your manufacturing process, and also the potential cues where you can insert yourself into everyday life. Now, let's talk about this book, right? I read the book twice. I also listened to a number of podcasts, which were super helpful in some of the research for this, and I'm going to be linking them down below. Ogilvy says read this 7 times before even thinking about writing an ad. The guy who was interviewed in this specific podcast said that he read it 50 times. But I think without a lot of context and experience, a lot of the learnings in this book is going to be totally lost on someone. I would never suggest someone who wants a career in advertising to start here. If you have a little bit of experience, definitely start here. I would say actually in many ways, this Ogilvy on advertising is like the graduated version of this because Ogilvy loved this so much, but he was like, oh, like people need pictures to understand what the hell is going on. To be honest, this is like reading a car manual, which is not great reading, but can be really interesting for people who are really deep in the trenches. But what's kind of interesting is it's not like a textbook like it claims to be. In many ways, it feels more like a manifesto. Let me read you the beginning of this book, because when I first read it, I got really excited as someone who kind of feels at times that ad creative can be like shooting into the dark. The time has come when advertising has in some hand reached the status of science. It is based on fiction. ethics principles and is reasonably exact. Advertising, once a gamble, has thus become one of the safest business ventures. Certainly no other enterprise with comparable possibilities need involve so little risk. I think that a lot of the brands and businesses that I talk about with Facebook ads, they don't feel like advertising is a sure thing. In fact, I remember even as a beginner, I felt like there was so much that was unknown and so much that you just had to test and it was always changing. I feel like, you know, when I first read that, it was really exciting. It was really exciting for me as a performance marketer. I think any performance marketer would be stoked to read that. But the actual learnings in here are really surface level. It's not going to guide you through ad creative and campaigns and really point out examples. It's not gonna really be able to contextualize these learnings. For example, in chapter 6, the chapter on psychology, he talks about how curiosity is one of the strongest human incentives. So here he's talking about puffed wheat and puffed rice. It was really hard to understand what he was talking about here without actually seeing the ad. But another thing that he has here too is that cheapness is not a strong appeal because Americans are so extravagant. They want bargains, not cheapness. They want to feel like they can afford to eat, but also have and wear the best. And if you treat them as if they couldn't, they will resent your attitude. So this is the type of learning that you're gonna get from this. It's something that, you know, feels really surface level. It lacks a lot of context. But I did find a lot of these like smaller examples interesting, but with the knowledge of some of the historical things going on at that time and with knowledge of the ads, that's when this book came to life for me. Now, one of the things that I don't agree with that he talks about, page 81, negative advertising. So here he essentially talks about how leaning into the negative is something that never works and you should never do it. And I think that this is something that I've seen refuted in our modern era. You know, leaning into the idea of mistakes and regret and negative marketing is something that I've really seen a lot of success with, especially when looking at higher hook rates, higher conversion rates. But it's something that he claims is something you should never do, which again, I think is why it's so important to have context of the time that he wrote this. And this book was published in 1923. So a few years after World War I, where people really wanted to have a lot more of that positive disposition. I don't know, it's like one of those things that's not an exact science, right? A big learning that was underscored for me with this book is that ads don't happen in a vacuum. Books don't happen in a vacuum. No media happens in a vacuum. And they are really subject to how the public and how society are going to interact with them at any point in time. The way that we would interact with a Schultz beer ad in today's time is way different than the way that people were interacting with it at that time. So in the end, I do understand and agree with the pedestal that this book has been put on, but I don't think that it's right for many advertisers coming out of the gate to invest their time in reading. I mean, the good thing is this is a very thin book. You can read it in under an hour. Maybe it is worth it, but I actually think that without having a lot of context that's not in this book, the meanings and the learnings are going to be lost on most people. I've been working in the advertising industry for almost 10 years, and the first time that I read it, I was like, but again, after I went through, really studied a lot more of Hopkins ads and also did some historical research on the time, that's when I was able to see this book in the way that a lot of the great advertisers of our time and the time before us see this. I don't know, maybe we're not gonna squeeze every single learning out of this book like I initially intended, but I think that's kind of the point. I think really you're gonna get the most juice from the idea of this book by studying the ads. And then, you know, maybe it's something we'll visit once a year, read once a year. Maybe I'll read it again in a year and review it then. All right, for next time, I am going to be reading a little bit more of a thicker book, A Big Life in Advertising, Mary Wells Lawrence. I'm willing to bet that this is an advertising great that you have not heard of, but you should. She was the creator of some of the most impactful campaigns of the last century. And, you know, was the person that the character Peggy was based off of. If you know, you know. So we'll be reviewing this book next time, and I will see you next week. Bye.